Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship. So I'm Melissa McDade, the pastor here at Norrisville and also at St. Paul. And if you're at home watching, we're glad you're with us. A couple of announcements.
Put the microphone on. McComas's Funeral Home contacted me a number of weeks ago and sent me a flyer. They're having a Father's Day food truck on Friday, June 18th from 11 to 2 down at McComas's in Jarrettsville, what they call the Celebration of Life Center. They did this last year, at that time they honored veterans, and all veterans got a sandwich free. This year, they're doing it for Father's Day, and all fathers get a sandwich free at this food truck. And then anybody else that comes is asked to contribute a $5 donation. And the connection with us is that then the donations are going to come to the Sunflower Fund to help the whole community. So I thought that was really neat. It's their way of reaching out to the community and touching more families. So that was a great idea. The other announcements that I wanted to share real quick is St. Paul's having their Strawberry Festival on Saturday, June the 5th from 3 to 6 p.m. So come, it's a drive-through, pit ham, beef, turkey, strawberries and ice cream. It's a lot of fun. Next week, we're going to start our, we usually collect change every first Sunday of the month, and that change in both St. Paul and Norrisville goes to missions. So if you're coming to church, bring your change along with you. I think that's all the announcements I had. So let's rise for the call to worship. With glad and generous hearts, come praising God this day. Open to the experiencing God in this place. It is good to be gathered together in Christ's name. May our strengths be renewed and our connection to God be strengthened through our worship today. Let's sing hymn number 546. If you can put your masks on, that's CDC recommendation for singing. I got to find mine. And we're singing the words on 546. I know the music's on 545. We can handle that.
Our longing eyes are blessed, and the grace.
Or one more?
With God the free and one, and share through faith communion with those whose rest is won. Oh, happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them, the meek and lowly, on high may.
When we can't hear each other singing, I forget which verse we're on. So I think we got it. Please be seated. Please join with me in prayer. Wonderful God, we come before you today remembering how your early church shared so intentionally with each other the blessings of life. They lived together, shared everything together, and became a family together. We often wonder if we could live like they did. We often hold back and are less than generous. Teach us the lessons of the early church. Just as you increased them in number, increase us as well. Make our lives roomier for your presence and for how we might make that presence real in the world today. Amen. Both of our scripture lessons today come to us from the book of Acts. I mentioned, I think 2 weeks ago, that we're going to start a series for the summer on the book of Acts and kind of go through it, learn a little bit more about the early church, which is what we're going to concentrate on today. As time goes on, we're going to get into some of the characters in the book of Acts, Peter and Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch and all sorts of different kinds of characters in and around the early church. So it should be a lot of fun. So this is from chapter 2, verses 42 through 47, the first reading, and tells us what happened in the early church. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. All came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. We move on to chapter 4 in Acts. And I'm going to read just verses 32 through 35, where it says, "Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul. And no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they held was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all." I love that "great grace" phrase. "There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need." Here ends the reading of our scripture for today. May God add understanding to all of us. So now Cooper and Weston kind of have heard this already, but they're going to help me too, right? So tell everybody what I have here, Coop and Weston. Not chocolate chips.
Chocolate kisses.
Chocolate kisses. I have a basket full of chocolate kisses. Wait a minute. Before you say that, I want to keep them for myself.
No.
What should share them? You mean?
Sharing is caring.
Oh, that's right. And that's what the early church did. So it's a reminder for all of us. Okay, guys, come up here and get the basket, and you can take them around. No, let Weston take the basket, and you take a big handful here. All right, got it. Take it, please. All right. Okay. All right. You go on that side. All right. Everybody gets one. second, Miss Doreen. If you're at home, you should grab a Hershey Kiss, too, or something else that maybe you could share with somebody at home. All right. That's Weston. That's okay. All right. Yeah. Okay, we got everybody? Good job, guys. All right, bring the basket back up and sit it on the front pew, please. And make sure you get your own. Get one. So. Get one. Just one. Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay, Weston, and put the basket on the front pew, please. Put the just put the basket there on the front pew. That's good. Thank you. Now let's pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Years ago, there used to be travel guides that were kind of like lift the flap books for little kids. And I'm not sure if they still make them or not. And most travel guides have gone virtual now. But you would have, back in the day, a guide to a certain country or perhaps a city. And when you opened it up, you would find some of their famous buildings or places of interest, like a famous cathedral or historic site that would fold out before you in three dimensions. One in particular that I read about featured the Metropolitan Cathedral in Mexico City. And the upper portion of the building is separated and lifted up and kind of moved a bit to the side so that you can look inside and also see it from the outside at the same time. You can basically see the exterior of the building and see what's inside at the same time. And our scripture lessons this morning are kind of the same thing when you think about it. It's as if the roof is taken off the early church. Not necessarily of their building, because they really didn't have a building per se, but the roof is lifted off so you can see their activities and their priorities and their customs and their life together, not just on Sundays, but all through the week. As we look inside the original church in Jerusalem, we can see what we might rediscover about their church life, about the kind of Christian community whose footsteps we follow in today. And we don't have a whole lot of information about the early church. After all, it was illegal in many places to gather for worship of Jesus in those early years. So it wasn't like they were writing things down and passing papers out to advertise their church. But we do have an account from a fellow named Justin, who wrote about a small church in Rome around the year 150. And this is what he had to say. On the day which is called Sunday, all who live in the cities or in the countryside gather together in one place, and the memoirs of the apostles or the writing of the prophets are read as long as there is time. And then when the reader is finished, the president, in a discourse, admonishes and invites the people to practice these examples of virtue. And then we all stand up together and offer prayers, and bread is presented and wine with water. The president likewise offers up prayers and thanksgivings according to his ability, and the people assent by saying amen. The elements, which have been eucharitized, never heard that word before, are distributed and received by each one, and they are sent to the absent by the deacons. Those who are prosperous, if they wish, contribute what each one deems appropriate, and the collection is deposited with the president. And he takes care of the widows and orphans, and those who are needy because of sickness or other cause, and the captives and the strangers who sojourn amongst us. In brief, he is the curate of all who are in need. Now, like I said, that was around the year 150, probably 60 or 70 years after Luke wrote. Okay, you go. Do you need somebody to go with you? Do you want to help him, Cooper? Thank you. All right. So, okay. Shh. Okay, now. Shh. Okay, it's in here. Yes. So they'll leave the door open, I'm sure. So anyway, the year 150 was about 60 or 70 years after Luke wrote our book of Acts that we read earlier. And it sounds like the pattern that Acts 2 talks about is really being lived out. I wonder now if we have moved too far away from the way, from the mission of the early church, if we've forgotten what we're really all about. First, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings. And that means they listened to the apostles. They were in touch with those who knew Jesus personally at that stage, maybe not by 150, but at least by the time Acts was written, those who had seen him and touched him and been healed by Jesus. And as those years passed and there were less and less of those who actually knew Jesus still alive, they started writing down their stories. The early church paid close attention to what we have in those stories today, what we call gospels and then epistles in the New Testament. They were letters that Paul wrote. And essentially, they are all writings about how we should live in light of knowing Jesus. When you devote yourselves to something, you take it seriously. You don't just pay it lip service. It's not just a Sunday morning thing or a when it's convenient thing. They also devoted themselves to fellowship. And that sounds pretty easy for us. We like fellowship. It sounds a little bit more fun. Until we get to the next part of what's said, which is in the breaking of bread and prayers. And that might make us a little nervous. But really, it's not. Breaking bread is simply eating together. And sometimes it was on Sunday mornings during communion, but more likely it was simply enjoying a fellowship meal any day during the week. So that brings up a question for all of us today. When was the last time you had someone from our church to your home for a meal? Or took them to a restaurant or to a picnic someplace, especially somebody in your church that might be new or somebody you don't know well. Now, I know we have the excuse of it being a pandemic for over a year now, but what about before that? So as I read this, I thought, you know, this is a biblical thing that we should be following. We should be giving this a try more often than I think we do. One of the things I think the early church has lost in all of our busyness these days is the concept that our church friends are our friends, people that we spend time with other than Sunday mornings. When we did Carl's memorial here at Norrisville this week, a little bit of that came out because Carl and Mary spent their time often with other church folks and were committed to all of us here together. It's time to reactivate that tradition, I think. The early church also reminds us that fellowship has a spiritual component as well. They prayed together. I've told some of you this before, but as I travel around to other churches, I see and feel a significant difference in the spirit present when prayer concerns are shared, when we are open and honest about our needs and our concerns. When I'm in a congregation that doesn't share a single thing, doesn't say a word, doesn't offer up a prayer, the worship kind of falls flat. So how we contribute in that time where we share prayer concerns and thanksgivings and things like that means a lot. And it helps folks get to know each other a little better than if we're all sitting here quiet as a mouse. In the early church, wonders were done among them. And I could name a whole bunch of wonders that have happened here over the years. Bodies and souls being healed, people seeing God's love in new ways, people acting out God's love in new ways. But sometimes the wonder is that someone who feels completely unloved or unloving or unlovable finds love. You want to do something wondrous like they did in the early church? Love someone with some encouraging words or a helping hand. The book of Acts also tells us that they held all of their property in common. A friend I have always calls this the socialist part of the Bible, just to raise a few eyebrows in his church. But then he explains that folks in the early church were intentional about their sharing and their mutual support. And just passing around candy is a little tiny example of how that could happen in much bigger ways as well. It reminds us that the best things we do are what we do for others. And the Bible tells us, and day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple praising God, in other words, they worshiped together regularly and often, not just on Sundays, but often. They knew how important being together as was for their church and for their lives as individuals, for their faith as individuals. They knew how important regular worship was with a community of faith, and how important that was. As the first passage ends with, and the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. So what we do in all that sharing brings people closer to God, brings people closer to God who maybe don't know about God. When you get right down to it, this church thing is pretty simple. It's about people being together for worship and for service. You know, I used to say often that you can't do church at home in front of a TV, no matter what a TV evangelist might be saying or what you might be hearing, a good message or some good music. And now I've had to eat those words. Since we have been forced to go virtual for much of this past year, we have found that, surprise, we can be the church in different places. The church is, after all, not a building. We don't go to church, we are the church. And as we read the scripture, we worship together and then we go out to serve. Our faith is not something that happens just for an hour a week. It's something that we do every single day. Now, this passage also says some things, how do I want to say this? There are some things not in this passage that we need to hear too. You notice that nowhere does it say they all got along, that they all liked each other, that they all agreed on everything. Writer Philip Yancey reminds us that Christianity is not purely an intellectual, internal kind of faith. It can only be lived in community. And that goes back to the old saying, you can't be a Christian alone. Many may try, but that's just not the way it works. In fact, that all that is mentioned might just be the all that is felt when something is accomplished among people who are very different from each other. So when folks walked into this church for the first time after we've done the renovations, there was a sense of awe. So, and something was accomplished that we could see and feel and be a part of. The wonder they felt was probably that incredulous feeling of suddenly somebody getting along with somebody you can't stand. Or in today's lingo, somebody from a different political party than what you are. These generous hearts were probably so overwhelmed that love just flowed out naturally. And that's what happens when you allow yourself to be led by God's Spirit. It also does not say that the preacher always said things they agreed with, nor that these things were not a challenge for them, nor that they didn't have time for all these things that God was calling them to do. If you study this passage in Acts, as we're going to do throughout the summer a bit, you'll find that it's part of that larger sermon by Peter that happened on that first Pentecost. And you might also find, as you study, that there are many biblical scholars who don't believe that the things Peter talked about in these passages ever really happened. At least, not on a consistent basis in every early church community. So you might think, well, we're off the hook. Maybe we all don't have to get along so well. Why should we even try if what it says in the Bible isn't really true and accurate? Well, years ago, Philip Yancey wrote a book called The Church, Why Bother? And he writes about trying to be the church. And I'm going to share with you a couple of pages because I think he hits the nail on the head with this. He says, C.S. Lewis wrote that God seems to do nothing of himself which he can possibly delegate to his creatures. God commands us to do slowly and blunderingly what God could do perfectly and in the twinkling of an eye. There is no greater illustration of that principle than the Church of Jesus Christ. to which God has delegated the task of embodying God's presence in the world. All of our efforts are examples of God's delegation. Every parent knows something of the risk of delegation with all its joy and heartache. The child taking her very first steps holds on and then lets go and falls and then struggles to her feet for another attempt. No one has discovered another way to learn to walk. So yes, the church fails in its mission and makes serious blunders precisely because the church comprises human beings who will always fall short of the glory of God. That's the risk God took. Anyone who enters the church expecting perfection does not understand the nature and the risk, the nature of that risk or the nature of humanity. Just as every romantic eventually learns that marriage is the beginning, not the end, of the struggle to make love work, every Christian must learn that the church is also just the beginning. I like that. The composer Igor Stravinsky once wrote a new piece that contained a very difficult violin passage. After several weeks of rehearsal, the solo violinist came to Stravinsky and said that he just simply could not play it. He had given it his best effort, but found the passage too difficult, even unplayable. Stravinsky replied, "I understand that. What I am after is the sound of someone trying to play it." Perhaps something similar is what God had in mind with the church. Yancey goes on and says, "I remember hearing a similar illustration from Earl Palmer." I laugh when I read this because when I was a kid, there was an Earl Palmer who lived in Hereford, and we all knew him. But anyway, this Earl Palmer is a pastor who was defending the church against critics who dismissed it for its hypocrisy, its failures, its inability to measure up to the New Testament's high standards. Palmer, a Californian at the time, deliberately chose a community known for its cultural unsophistication. And he says, "When the Milpitas High School Orchestra attempts Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, the result is appalling. I wouldn't be surprised if the performance made old Ludwig roll over in his grave despite his deafness." You might ask, why bother? Why inflict on those poor kids the terrible burden of trying to render what the immortal Beethoven had in mind? Not even the great Chicago Symphony Orchestra can attain that kind of perfection. My answer is this. The Milpitas High School Orchestra will give some people in that audience their only encounter with Beethoven's great Ninth Symphony. Far from perfection, it is nevertheless the only way they will hear Beethoven's message. He goes on by saying, "I remind myself of Earl Palmer's analogy whenever I start squirming in a church service. Although we may never achieve what the composer had in mind, there is no other way for those sounds to be heard." My friends, perfect or not, we may be the only church someone else ever sees. So let's make it a good one. Let us pray. Oh, gracious God, we give you thanks for the church in all its forms, with all its problems, with all the miracles and ways it is so very special. Guide each and every one of us to remember the lessons of the early church and work each day to strengthen the church we have. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Now it's time to share our prayer concerns and joys and thanksgivings. Anybody think of anything they want to add before I share online what we're going to pray about? Okay. Just wanted to remind you. So some of our regulars, but then also some extras that I want to add. Jim Schwartzler is home and doing well. Had three stints this week, so needs our prayers still. The McRoberts family as they grieve. Linda's friend Tom with a brain tumor, we want to keep in our prayers. Ruthie's brother Glenn got some new medications this week, so that should help with his blood disease. I mentioned earlier the Dietz family and their grief, so keep them in your prayers, and the Elmore family as well. The Enzer family, as their dad, as their grandfather, journeys home to heaven, so keep them in your prayers. The Pig family and those that have been infected with COVID, so keep those folks in your prayers as well. Let's bow in prayer. Oh, holy God, as churches come back together, as the COVID rates decrease, as we see our churches facing challenges to our structures forced by that pandemic, we give thanks for the example of the early church that reminds us that no matter what changes the future may bring, your word offers basics of worship and service to guide all of us. Move us to be more devoted, to know the importance of the apostles' teaching and fellowship, of breaking of bread together and praying. Bless our congregation with more of a desire to study scripture, and place within each of us a desire to learn more of your word, not to affirm our own beliefs, but to stretch us in love and acceptance of all your children. Help us each to more deeply engage in prayer, not the kind of prayer that asks for things, but the prayers that bring us closer to you. Lord, bring us together in fellowship and sharing. Enable us to be more open in our giving and free us from our possessions. If someone is in need, open our eyes and our hearts to meet that need. Help us to learn the joy of sharing and the joy of being a part of your church family. As we pray for others, may our prayers be more than words, but actions that reach out in love and service. Hear our prayers for all those still battling COVID, for those on the front lines working each day, for those struggling in body and mind, for those who grieve. Hear our prayers for peace in the Middle East, for all those reeling from the mass shootings again this week, for all those who have served our country, and especially for families who have lost loved ones in their service. And we pray for Dave and Michael, for Linda, for Janice and Leanne, for Adam and Molly, for Caleb and his family, for Bob and Joan and Carol and Ellen. We pray for Craig, for Ernest and Angela, for Johnny, for Gigi and her family, for Bonnie and Daryl, for Nancy, for Angeline, for Doreen, for George and his family, for the McRoberts, for Jim and Vicky, for Tom and Glenn, for the Dietzes and the Elmores, for Vic and his family, for Andy and his family, for all those known only in our hearts. Hear these, our prayers, that we might be the church you call us to be. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen. Now let's share our blessings. Cooper and Weston can work on this, but they need help. Cooper and Weston, you want to come? Do this side. Thank you. Our final hymn for this morning are New Words by Carolyn Winfrey Gillette, and she does a beautiful job. I just love this. We might be singing it more often. For our benediction today, I'm going to read that passage from Acts one more time, from the second chapter 1, because I think it's so important for us to remember. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. All came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. My friends, be safe and go in peace in all that you do. Amen. Thank you.